On March 4th, 2022, Microsoft announced that they had completed a $19.7 billion cash acquisition, their second largest acquisition of all time. What company did they buy, you ask? Maybe LinkedIn, GitHub, or Activision Blizzard? Well, it was actually a company that you've probably never heard of, Nuance Communications. On the surface, Nuance is a speech recognition and speech synthesis company. So you would naturally think that Nuance is some sort of AI-based voice assistant play, something like Siri or Alexa, probably to make Cortana better. But that wasn't why Microsoft bought Nuance. Well then, maybe they bought Nuance as a chatbot play. Speech synthesis technology could be a massive help for ChatGPT to form natural sentences and paragraphs. But that wasn't why Microsoft bought Nuance either. Well, in that case, Nuance must have been a market share play, right? Nuance must have controlled a massive portion of the market within the speech technology world. Well, that's partially true in that Nuance was indeed a market share play, but not in the way that you might expect. Nuance didn't have massive market share against any of the traditional players, whether it be Google Assistant or ChatGPT. In fact, Nuance doesn't have all that much to do with the traditional tech industry in general. But then again, it's not like Microsoft needs that much help in this area anyway. And that's why the Nuance deal was actually about breaking into a completely different industry, one that Microsoft doesn't control, the healthcare industry. You see, over the past few decades, Nuance has built a reputation as the go-to platform for hospitals and physicians. In fact, 55% of physicians, 75% of radiologists, and 77% of American hospitals use Nuance solutions. So, by purchasing Nuance, Microsoft immediately became the dominant player within the healthcare industry. But all of that is just the beginning, as Microsoft has much grander ambitions with Nuance. So here's why Microsoft really spent $20 billion to buy a no-name company. A lot of us probably discount the healthcare sector because it's not exactly the most shiny or glamorous. They don't have massive product launches like Apple or Google, nor do they have the same brand or reputation. But the healthcare industry is one of those background giants that's actually extremely powerful. In fact, even more powerful than the tech industry. In the US, for example, healthcare accounts for over 18% of the national GDP, or about $4.3 trillion per year. For perspective, the tech industry is only half as large, accounting for only 9.3% of the American GDP, or just under $2 trillion. But not only is the healthcare industry already massive, but they're expected to continue growing at a record pace of 5.4% over the next decade. Tech, on the other hand, has actually been on a decline in terms of GDP contribution. In fact, 2022 was lower than 2017. And given that Microsoft is already one of the largest players within the tech industry, it's no wonder why they're trying to expand their horizons to other massive industries. But ironically, Nuance didn't start off as a healthcare-based tech company or a profit-oriented business in general. They actually traced their roots all the way back to 1974 to a man named Raymond Kurzweil. To be honest, I've never heard of Raymond till now, but looking into his background, this man is absolutely stacked, not in terms of wealth like other people we cover, but in terms of contributions. The man is a first-class academic scholar and inventor with dozens and dozens of contributions that companies have gone on to commercialize to great success. Just to give you a sense of his accomplishments, Ray has earned 21 honorary doctorates, honors from 3 US presidents, and is named as one of the 16 revolutionaries that made America. And even before he founded the precursor to Nuance Communications, Ray was doing massive things. It turns out that while he was in college, he managed to create an application sorting software that could match high school students with colleges. And he would go on to sell this company shortly after for $100,000 plus royalties, which is the same as $750,000 2020. So it's safe to say that Ray was financially set by the time that he was in his mid-20s. But that didn't stop him from inventing, which brings us into Kurzweil Computer Products Inc. in 1974. Ray's goal with this company was to create the world's first OmniFont optical character recognition software. You're probably familiar with Apple's Live Text feature that they launched a few years ago. Live Text allows you to copy text from images. And this is precisely the technology that Ray was developing, only 50 years ago. He would succeed within just a year actually, but there was one major problem. Ray had no obvious way to monetize this invention. Worse, he was focusing on applications that weren't all that lucrative, though they were noble. Their first application, for example, was to create the world's first print-to-speech reading machines for the blind. While this invention did earn them some notoriety on the news, it didn't provide them with all that much revenue. In fact, Ray admits that by 1978, they were scrambling to raise funds. And as such, they would pivot into more commercial applications of this technology, such as scanning documents into databases. And this endeavor would catch the attention of the tech leader of the time, Xerox. Xerox had spent decades figuring out how to convert digital text into physical text, and the startup had built a bridge backwards. So this technology fit perfectly into Xerox's arsenal. And they would buy the company in 1980 for a modest $3.6 million. But all of this was just the beginning. The Xerox acquisition didn't really change anything about Kurzweil Computer Products, because Xerox was a pretty chill company. In fact, they were probably way too chill for their own good. If you didn't know, Xerox basically missed out on multiple $100 billion opportunities that they created, from laptops and computers to Microsoft Office and object-oriented programming. How, you ask? Well, Xerox was never all that concerned about protecting their intellectual property or commercializing these insane inventions, largely because they were overconfident in their photocopying business, which eventually got destroyed. But while this mindset wasn't all that great for Xerox as a whole, it was great for Kurzweil. He basically had the freedom to experiment with whatever he wanted, and Xerox would bankroll his efforts. And let's just say, Ray took full advantage of this. Instead of focusing on commercial applications, Ray would revert to focusing on text-to-speech for the blind. He would implement compatibility for several languages, including French, German, Italian, Spanish, and Swedish. And he would package all of this technology into a streamlined product, the Kurzweil Personal Reader, which launched in April of 1988. The Kurzweil Personal Reader was by no means cheap, coming in at $8,000 to $12,000. But that was simply how much it cost to build such technology back in the 80s. As Windows computers started to gain popularity, Ray would bring this technology to Windows as well through a piece of software called TextBridge. Fun fact, this software is still available on Xerox's website to this day, though it hasn't been updated in nearly 20 years. But while TextBridge lives on to this day, Ray wouldn't stick around at Xerox for much longer. In 1995, Ray would leave to create Kurzweil Educational Systems, which focused on helping people with dyslexia and ADHD. But while Ray was no longer involved in the picture, Kurzweil Computer Products would continue to evolve and grow. Under Xerox, it was known as Xerox Imaging Systems before becoming ScanSoft. Honestly, it would have been in Xerox's best interest to hold on to ScanSoft for as long as possible. But let's not forget, these are the same people that sold their 5-8% stake in Apple for just $1.2 million. So it's not all that surprising that Xerox dropped a ball with ScanSoft as well, selling them off to Visioneer in 1998. From there, ScanSoft would engage in a series of acquisitions and mergers to expand their product portfolio from just text recognition to speech recognition. Likely the most notable of these acquisitions was Nuance for $220 million in 2005. Nuance was a relatively new company that had launched a hit product named Dragon Naturally Speaking in 1997. As the name suggests, Dragon Naturally Speaking was focused on deciphering voice commands, speech-to-text, and text-to-speech. Technically, Dragon is a Windows software that basically anyone can get if they want. But for the most part, Dragon was something that was recommended by doctors and healthcare providers to people with various disabilities. And when ScanSoft acquired Nuance, they decided to take on their name, leading to the creation of Nuance Communications. Over the years, Nuance managed to grow pretty large in terms of market cap, but their vision and purpose was never really clouded. Despite being in the extremely lucrative industry of healthcare and controlling 77% of the market, Nuance never really made all that much money themselves. Even at their peak, they were only pulling in $2 billion. For perspective, United Health Group, the largest insurance provider in America, pulls in $324 billion per year. So it turns out that the company that's supposed to be protecting Americans from large medical bills is pulling in hundreds of billions per year, while the company actually helping people with disabilities is only pulling in $2 billion. And that's just from a revenue perspective. If you look at net income, you'll see that Nuance has basically never been consistently profitable. They've maintained more of a break-even financial profile, earning or losing $100 to $200 million in any given year. And this is precisely why so many people are worried about the Microsoft acquisition. Nuance has historically been a company with very noble intentions. wealth was something that always followed for them, not something that led. And people are worried that this will change with Microsoft's influence. I mean, there's no question that Microsoft's intentions with Nuance are very opportunistic. They basically saw that this company was killing it within the healthcare industry, something that most tech companies had no control over. So they went ahead and bought Nuance, not to control speech recognition or whatever, but to win influence over the healthcare industry. Over the past 50 years, Nuance has built deep, long-lasting relationships with thousands of hospitals and hundreds of thousands of doctors. This gives them the perfect opportunity to use these connections to push Microsoft Azure to the entire healthcare industry. And given that Microsoft has an entire website about how Microsoft Cloud can be used for healthcare, it does seem like this is their real angle with Nuance. With that being said though, Microsoft does have a history of being very lenient with their acquisitions. Whether it's LinkedIn or GitHub, Microsoft pretty much gives them full rein of how to run their companies. In fact, it's almost as if these companies are completely independent of Microsoft. And given that Nuance's CEO Mark Benjamin has stuck around, it seems that relations between Nuance and Microsoft are going pretty well. So it may be the case that Microsoft is willing to let Nuance do whatever they want when it comes to speech recognition while bankrolling all of their operations. All Microsoft wants in return is some business from Nuance's healthcare customers. And that's why Microsoft spent $20 billion buying a no-name company. With historically high interest rates, the appeal of bills and bonds is higher than ever, yet traditional brokerages haven't really adapted with the times. They still expect people to use clunky bond tables, scroll through long, overwhelming lists, and even use virtual keyboards till recently. And that's why we created our own modern bond platform, Silo. At Silo, we prioritize the user experience and the ease of finding and investing in the issuers you know and trust, so that you too can easily lock in high yields. Also, choosing a strong user experience does not mean sacrificing on safety. Every Silo account is insured by $500,000 in SIPC insurance and $2.5 million in FDIC insurance. Also, all funds deposited on the platform will be maintained by our trusted custodian, Interactive Brokers, who has experience managing $373 billion worth of assets over the past 45 years. So, if you're looking for a modern way to invest in bonds, please consider checking out Silo in the description below. Do you think this is a fair deal? Comment that down below. Microsoft is also making some major moves within the social media space. Check out this video to learn more, but until then, I'm Hari, and I'll see you guys on the next one.